4,000 miles from Broadway, the bright lights of London's West End, the home of my wife and I for the last 6 months. How come? We've been giving 8 performances a week in the play Mr. Roberts at the London Coliseum.
Weren't they a wonderful audience tonight?
Yes, they were. But we still have another audience to meet this evening.
Oh?
Right here, you see?
Oh.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to meet Mrs. Cooper. Or as long as we're still in costume, Miss Hildy Parks.
How do you do?
Now, honey, I want to have a word with the folks here, and you better hurry and change, because we've got a date, remember?
Pardon me.
Well, it's London for a few more days, then Paris, and then a holiday, we hope. That's the way it is in this business. Today you're here, tomorrow you're someplace else. But just between you and me, we'd be a little sorry to leave Britain. We've seen quite a bit here, and it's made us think. You see, we haven't spent all our time on a stage. No, sir. We've been getting around.
Now this, not far from our theater, is Trafalgar Square. See that little English car? See those people in it? Well, those are the Coopers, rubbernecking. Seeing the things that, well, you should see. You know, it's quite a place, this Britain. It's got a climate all its own. And crowds of British and Americans all ruining each other's language. But somehow it holds you. To us, fresh from the new world, this was really the old world. It's just jammed solid with old things. A lot of those old things you and I would want to throw away. And a lot of them, we just give our eye teeth to have. Any day, anywhere you're walking in London, you can come right up against history. And before you know it, you're part of history yourself. For just since we came here, one of the greatest dramas of Britain's history has unfolded right before our eyes. A drama of a nation which, for all its tradition and pageantry, all its greatness and strength, was in a shaky condition. Until a good neighbor came along with a helping hand called the Marshall Plan. Maybe we couldn't get a better angle on this drama of Britain's recovery than from right here, alongside the River Thames, just across from where the last act ended. There we looked over at the gray old walls of the Houses of Parliament, where the British have been making democracy work for 700 years. That's quite a time, and that's quite a lot of history to stand and think about. But what was that last act I was telling you about? Oh, yes. That was quite a moment, both for the U.S. and for Britain. The moment in the House of Commons when the British Chancellor of the Exchequer, that's like our Mr. Snyder, Hugh Gaitskill, said,
"The governments of the United States and the United Kingdom have agreed to the suspension of martial aid to the United Kingdom from January the 1st, 1951. His Majesty's government desires to express, on behalf of the whole nation, its deepest gratitude to the government and people of the United States for their unprecedented generosity in giving freely to Britain, at a critical moment in history, the means to regain her economic independence and power. We are not an emotional people, and we're not always very articulate. But these characteristics should not be allowed to hide the very real sense of gratitude we feel towards the American people, not only for the material help they have given us, but also for the spirit of understanding and friendship in which it has been given."
In Britain, like home, they have two main political parties. But on this issue, the opposition wholeheartedly supported the government. Mr. Anthony Eden said,
"No generosity could have been more freely given or more warmly appreciated than that which the United States has extended to Britain the need immediately of post-war Europe. And not to Britain only, but to the free countries throughout the world.
Well, what exactly had that generosity meant to Britain? As we looked out across the river, we tried to imagine what her struggle for economic survival had been like. Nowadays, you can't see how bad things were because things are so much better. There's still a long way to go, but the change has been remarkable. And for the most part, it's been due to the efforts of these British people. They've worked and slaved and done without, put off buying that new suit, cut down on the movies, lived on a tiny piece of meat one day a week, rationed sugar, rationed butter. When Mrs. Cooper shops today, she finds there's a lot to choose from. Mind you, it's only what's left over from the export drive. But it's a little different from those days only a short time ago when the hardware stores were empty of even the simplest household equipment, when the markets were cleaned out of everything but the strictly rationed foods. Now, all over the country, you see houses being built. For housing is still and will be for a long time yet Britain's greatest problem. A few years ago, they hadn't even the timber to support the tiles on the roofs, or the bricks, or the cement. And this in a country where one out of every five houses or factories had been damaged or destroyed by air raids. Now it's real good to see skilled men getting down to a skilled job. Today in the shipyards, you can't hear yourself speak. But in those days, such new construction meant steel, and a lot more than Britain could produce. Steel had to be brought from overseas. And think of the ships that had been sunk in 5 years of war. Yes? 3 years ago, Britain and the British people were in a spot. One that, well, isn't any too pleasant to think about. Somehow, they had to build those new houses and factories. Somehow, they had to restock those empty shops. And somehow, they had to build those ships. But most important of all, they had to build up their export trade, which is to them the difference between eating and, well, not eating. Yes, in Britain's financial world, just a few short years ago, there was a pile of figures on the wrong side of the ledger. Her overseas assets were gone. Her gold reserves were dwindling fast. She needed time in which to manufacture and export goods to earn dollars. She needed dollars to buy the time to do it in. Well, that's where martial aid came in. Now, a lot of you GIs will remember this place. Yes, it's Grosvenor Square in London, the home of the American Embassy. And it was there I dropped in to see Lamar King, administrative officer of ECA in Britain. He's the one to give you a true behind-the-scenes account of the way in which the people of Britain were helped by Uncle Sam.
Martial aid was more than a gesture of American belief in British staying power and integrity. With it, they were able to buy the raw materials, and therefore the time they needed to get their industrial machinery into full production again. Their industries couldn't operate without fuel, but their coal mines needed new machinery to step up their industrial output.
American mining equipment was rushed in, while they got down to the task of manufacturing their own specialized machinery for the thin seams of Britain's deep pits. Their generating plant had not been renewed during 5.5 years of war. Martial aid rushed them the vital equipment they needed to carry the load while they got to work building their own. In the lonely glens of Scotland, new dams, pipelines, generating stations began to rise. Here was the promise of a vast new hydroelectric scheme to power all Scotland and feed a current into Britain's overstrained network of cables. They needed new steel plants. Martial aid covered much of the dollar expenditure needed to build and equip them. And now, in South Wales, there is coming into production a steel plant which will outproduce the best in Europe. And all this time, 50 million mouths had to be fed. Unable to import a dollar's worth of food over and above sheer necessities, Britain stepped up her agricultural output. But her farms needed new implements, and her land was hungry for fertilizers.